Good evening. This is Peter Coleman. I am a faculty member at Columbia University. I direct the International Center for Cooperation and Conflict Resolution here, and I also direct a consortium with Beth Fisher Yoshida, which is called the Advanced Consortium on Cooperation, Conflict, and Complexity, which sponsors these half-hour segments. And tonight we have the pleasure of having Aldo Civico, who is a professor at Rutgers University. But I met Aldo years ago when he was directing the Center for International Conflict Resolution here at Columbia University at the School of International Public Affairs. So Aldo, welcome. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Peter, for inviting me in. I want to say hi to everyone who is listening to us tonight.
Great. So Aldo, you give us a little bit about your background. Aldo has a degree in anthropology, so he takes up his work in a very specific way. But tell us a little bit about how you got to Columbia.
Well, as you can maybe guess from my Irish accent, I'm Italian, and I came here to New York in the year 2000 with the idea of doing a master's degree in international affairs at Columbia University. I was working as a freelance journalist. And when I came here, I ran in our colleague and friend, Andrea Bartoli, a fellow Italian as well, and who welcomed me at the Center for International Conflict Resolution. And for me, it was as a researcher, and it was for me very interesting because somehow he introduced me to the field of conflict resolution, of which I had a very narrow sense. I thought it was related just to diplomacy, but not more than that. So mm-hmm. something very official and very narrow defined. But in knowing more about Andrea's experience, I realized that many of the things that I was doing in Italy, I was very active in the social movement against the mafia in Sicily. I was there working with anti-mafia leader Luca Orlando, who is today the mayor of Palermo. And I realized I could read my experience through the lenses of conflict resolution and see how actually empowering civil society, the creativity that goes into that is actually an essential part to conflict resolution. So I changed my career and my field. And again, I think Andrea gave me one of the best advice I got in my life and said, you know, why you don't do a PhD and why you don't do a PhD in anthropology? The reason being that anthropology is a very holistic discipline, and conflict is very holistic in the ways it affects and it generates and in the kind of solution you want to find. And without thinking too much about it, too much, you know, I just trusted him.
Sure.
And I dived into this field. And that's how then I entered the field, both of conflict resolution and anthropology, and I did most of my work, my field work in Colombia.
So you, how long have you been working in Colombia?
You know, my first trip was in 2001, mm-hmm. So it's a little bit more than 10 years. And I went down to design my first ever conflict resolution workshop in this tiny village on the border between Colombia and Panama.
How did you get invited down?
If you want the methodology of the center, at least at the time, right, when you would just take any opportunity and you would learn by doing, mm-hmm. Which is also a great method.
Sure.
And a friend of mine invited me and he said, well, you are affiliated to the center. Why you don't help me with a conflict resolution workshop, designing it and leading? And I went to Andrea, I said, you know, I got this invitation, and Andrea said, just do it. And so I bought a few books, and Andrea and others helped me to design it. But when I got there, that's actually was a huge learning experience for me, because besides not having ever done it, what they told me is that because there was just a massacre by paramilitary had happened in that village, very tiny village. You know, we got there on a small plane, no roads, no, you know, the only way to get there was this small plane. And because the community was traumatized by the violence, they told me, you know, you cannot talk about conflict resolution and you cannot mm-hmm. talk about peace, mm-hmm. right? So for me, you know, then what do I do? That's why you called me, right? So and that for me was interesting because I discovered that I don't have to have the solutions, uh-huh. right? but they have to create somehow this space where people themselves come up with the suggestions, and I might facilitate and guide that. Mm-hmm. And so in talking to some of the colleagues and people there, we said, okay, we cannot talk, oh, of course, and then they told me, you know, you should not ask directly about the massacre, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Because you never know who is among our audience, and, people
might be enemies.
So, okay, then we said, you know, what we could do is why we don't reconstruct, rebuild the collective memory of this village. Uh-huh. And we asked just people to share the memories, what they heard from their grandfathers and grandmothers, mm-hmm. from their parents, and what their own experience was. Mm-hmm. And in the hope that we create an atmosphere safe, felt safe enough, perceived as safe, where people then eventually would also talk about the present.
Sure.
And sure enough, that's actually what happened. There were beautiful stories. I remember this woman who remembered the first time she actually saw a mirror in the village. She always had seen herself reflecting the water of the sea. Mm. And now finally she saw a mirror. So it was a beautiful story. And then another woman, and it's interesting actually that it was women who would be taking the courage of talking about the present, she shared the trauma of what happened, the massacres. Mm-hmm. And that was transformative and cathartic. Everybody would open up, and everybody then dwelt for the rest of the day talking about that, and people would cry listening to each other. But they discovered that the personal suffering and pain that they had concealed until that moment was actually a shared experience.
So and this is a pretty extraordinary first endeavor in conflict resolution.
You know, I did others, but it was certainly the best one, at least. Maybe because I remember so vividly before the first one. But it certainly taught me that, you know, your preoccupation is about creating that environment, that space of peace in the midst of violence. Yeah. You don't have to bring the solutions. You don't, but maybe the expertise stays in eliciting those stories, so that they
working
can
with wherever the village is. Right?
So
You have in the last few years moved, taken a position at Rutgers University, and you've launched a new center there.
I was there for a semester, and we were designing at the time with my colleagues a new master's in peace and conflict studies, rooted in social science. And so I come up talking with my colleagues. We come up with the idea of creating this institute, which with one uniqueness, I think, which is trying to look at urban violence and urban conflict. A little bit because we are in Newark, which is a city that is struggling, has been struggling for a long time with social conflict and violent conflict. But also from my own experience, especially in Latin America, and if you want my previous experience in Italy. Mm. I'm convinced that because of a dramatic change in demographic change we are witnessing, you know, UN reports say that 80% of the world population will live in urban centers. Mm-hmm. We will play out our conflicts and have to resolve them in urban areas. Mm-hmm. It's increasingly so, and I see in the public policy discourse very narrow definitions of security. We don't really have many times a paradigm that goes much beyond law enforcement and punitive and repressive kind of methods. It's an issue left up to the police, and I think that, you know, the police is important, but peace is too important to leave it just up to the law enforcement system. And sometimes, because problems are systemic, that's also not enough as a form of intervention. So when I created this institute, we said, you know, we will, our contribution want to be toward especially, you know, privileging urban areas and urban conflicts.
So now this is a center that is sponsored by UNESCO or is developed in collaboration with them?
We are officially, it's called a Category 2 UNESCO Center. Mm-hmm. Category 2 means that UNESCO doesn't give us money, otherwise we would be Category 1. That's the technical difference. But the beauty is that it actually requires a very deep due diligence process that is started by the government to which your university or institute belongs. In our case, it was the State Department who officially had to ask us, and it was a very good process in designing and for me also to discover much more in depth what actually UNESCO does in the field of peace. And I found that there was a unity of intent and mission, because UNESCO is about building minds women and men and on peace, around peace and a culture of peace, and that's very much what anthropology would like to contribute with a university and our institute in particular. So it was a perfect match.
Now you've joined forces and collaborated with Forrest Whitaker,
who played a very important role when we started, because he was a goodwill ambassador for peace at UNESCO. And I just met him a few weeks before he was appointed. And we met at a conference in Newark, and I was on a panel with the Dalai Lama, and I just shared the stories of the village of the Spaces of Peace, and somehow Forrest got intrigued by that. And so we said, why we don't collaborate? And say, I'm ambassador, but I don't have a space yet, my own space to do this. And
sure.
I said, okay, let's partner. And has been an venture since.
So is the focus thus far of the center mostly in Newark, or have you taken it elsewhere at this point?
No, we are very small, and also because I think there is a reason to do it methodologically, we decided to start from where we were already doing some work, not maybe as an institute, but individually. So certainly in Colombia, so we are present in Medellin, we are partnering with several people and groups on the ground there, and we have started to be present in Newark, and we do it slowly because Newark is also a very complex reality, has a very long history, and you want to be respectful of dynamics and the history of communities, and so you have to be accepted little by little. So we are not rushing it, but we are present.
Sure. So let's talk a little bit about your work in Medellin. You work with young people there and violence there. And you describe your approach as a sort of systems approach, about thinking systemically. What does that mean when you go into Medellin? How does that help you think about or work with youth and violence there?
Yeah, you know, the best way for me is always to understand the stories of people, right? Especially the most complex stories, or the one that are not clear cut between good and evil, right?
Sure.
And so maybe I share you a very recent story that helps me to think about this issue. It's the story of a young boy, 16 years old, Alex. I didn't meet him personally. I met him through the narrations of his friends. And the fact is that this kid was killed a week ago. And he was not a saint. He was actually a member of the gangs. And his story is that he comes from a very marginal areas in Medellin, from a very poor family. At some point, his cousin, which was like a brother to him, was killed. And so he was, you know, even though very young, like maybe 11, 12 years old, he was very resentful. But he met a group of kids, more or less his age, a little bit older, who were urban artists and were trying to use and are using, actually, especially graffitis, as a way of, as a cathartic way, as a way of creating different kinds of spaces. And so he became very close to them, and it was transformative for him, made him think of different scenarios in a different life. Problem is that there was an economic crisis in his family, so they couldn't pay any more of the rent, so they had to move to the uphills of Medellin, which in Medellin doesn't mean that you go into a good neighborhood,
right,
but actually to a very difficult neighborhood. And there, the boss of a major gang told him, well, I see you are struggling. You know, if you want, I help you, and you work for me. And so he recruited him in a gang. And Alex started doing the life of a gang and probably killed and did other stuff. And he was killed by a shop owner to whom Alex went for some extortion money, and probably this guy frustrated and angry and had enough and just shot him, and Alex died. And for me, this is a very interesting story, because then when you hear, you know, Iron Fist, or you hear politicians say, let's increase the presence of the police, my question is, would this do to the life of Alex? Would have done nothing. I mean, life was already tough enough, right? You ask other questions, say, okay, what kind of encounters did this Alex actually had with the state, which allowed him to have a positive relationship with the state and experience in the state beyond the punishment system, right? So we see how his life was actually enmeshed in conditions that are chronicled, right?
Mm-hmm. It's,
I would say that his life was more a clue into something which is much deeper.
Mm-hmm.
And are these dynamics within a system which need to be addressed.
Mm-hmm.
So you see that for a certain period of time, for example, this group of artists worked as inhibitors in his own life, but it saved probably a lot of other lives around Alex,
sure.
right?
Yeah.
But you also see that there were attractors stronger in his particular case that took his way, his life away. So I think only by unraveling the complexity of his life, for example, we could think of what citizen security means in Medellin today
mm-hmm.
in a completely different way than just targeting, you know, gangs as bad and their artists who
sure.
are doing graffiti good and
sure.
Or entire areas as taboos
yeah.
somehow
yeah.
that we don't even want to visit, not even want to go. And instead, there is a lot of creativity, there is a lot of life that needs to be highlighted.
Do you work there in partnership with members of the government or with
NGOs? I do it with a lot of different people. First, I do it with groups in communities. I think it's a sensitivity that we, as anthropologists, and I think as people also in the conflict resolution community try to have, is to work together with community in a very participatory process. So I try not to be the scholar who comes down from New York for a few days and then leaves, but actually, you know, whatever is illicit that somehow is useful for a community there. So I would say that first and foremost, my priority is with this very simple, I would even say powerless, group of young people who are artists.
Uh-huh.
Then I work with, I collaborate with a foundation which was founded by famous Colombian artist Juanes, who is a rock star and has this foundation very much involved in peace building.
Mm-hmm.
And they have very advanced methodologies in using education and the arts to do youth violent prevention.
Mm-hmm.
So that's another mm-hmm. channel and space. And I do work informally with some enlightened political leader, if you want, who tries to be innovative. And
mm-hmm.
in the case of Medellin, especially the current governor mm-hmm. is such a leader that is looking at these issues in a new way. He's a mathematician, maybe that's that helps.
Sure.
And I collaborate with them as well in terms of public policy advice and analysis and so on.
Sure. So you're an academic, right? You're in a university setting. And the work that you describe sounds more like community-based action.
Yeah.
It sounds more like potentially policy-making. Mm-hmm. How do you do your research? How do you systematically study the kinds of dynamics?
Yeah, but as an anthropologist, for me, the method is absolutely to ethnographic work, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's staying in the field for a long time, over a longer period of time, like, for example, you know, doing field work in Medellin
sure.
since 2003 methodologically.
Sure.
And so through observation, to taking notes, interviews, and all of that. And then, you know, thinking about it theoretically
mm-hmm.
And see how the experience and the life of people informs the theory and advance the theory.
Sure.
And then you write and give lectures and seminars. That's
right.
But I think that these arguments, these topics are too important and affecting the life of people in a too direct way to become only an intellectual and academic exercise.
Sure.
And so for me, if you want the public intellectual dimension, though certainly at the beginning in that sense, for example, I write a column every 2 weeks in a major Colombian newspaper,
mm-hmm.
is for me a way and an exercise also in translating the academic language and the temptation that we remain and talk among ourselves and we read ourselves and that
mm-hmm.
stays there,
mm-hmm.
trying, you know, without to be too pretentious, but yes, to try to affect somehow
mm-hmm.
Or question the world of public policy or even participating when possible in those processes.
Sure. So I have an academic question, which is that I know that there's a conflict, or has long been a conflict in the field of anthropology,
yeah,
between people that would say that you can study a place, a situation, and yeah, generalize from that to the human condition, and others that say, no, all you can do is learn about this place at this time with these folks.
Yeah.
And so, and do you fall somewhere on that spectrum? Do you feel like you can study a neighborhood or an artistic group in Medellin and glean some insight on the human condition around conflict, or is it?
Yeah, it is true that as anthropologists we are very cautious and prudent doing generalizations.
Right.
I realize that in myself. I'm very particular when I talk about Medellin, that it's not Medellin, but it's actually that sector of a city where you see those dynamics.
Right.
And it is a characteristic of anthropology, which I think it's a valid one, which you study great topics, but in the life of small people, but in great detail, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I think that that's really our contribution. I do think that then in conversation with others, there is the possibility of insights that can be generalized. Otherwise, we would not get to do public policy.
Sure.
We would just write beautiful narratives,
sure.
And life history of people.
Sure.
So it is an effort, but I do see that sometimes anthropologists have, maybe because they want to somehow conserve a certain purity of a discipline,
mm-hmm,
right? They don't engage much, for example, in public policy, mm-hmm, process. There is, you know, sometimes the concern for getting tainted.
Sure.
And it's a small, there are people who do it, there's a small group of people who do it. Now, anthropologists who, for example, who collaborate with the intelligence methodology, with the Pentagon, and are embedded in war, are strongly criticized, and
sure,
and I have my critic too, right?
Sure,
but
sure.
But also it tells you that anthropology would be actually a great tool in many ways, and I would prefer to use it for peace building,
sure,
to suggest a different approach and a different point of view. And I think we need to be a little bit more courageous as anthropology. For example, you know, it's interesting, anthropology don't talk much to perpetrators. You know, if you only the study of political violence is very recent in anthropology,
mm-hmm,
and the majority did it by lending an ear to victims,
mm-hmm,
or when it's the case of perpetrators, it's revolutionary kinds of types.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's causes you can somehow sympathize. You might not sympathize,
sure,
with methods, but you know, liberation, Northern Ireland, or the Basque Country is something that you know you can,
sure,
sympathize, right?
Sure, sure.
With the really bad guy, you know, with the gangs. And with the paramilitaries and death squad,
yeah,
it's even more rare. So mm-hmm, I think there is a lot, and there is a value in studying perpetrators and not only victims. And
mm-hmm,
so I think there is still room for anthropology,
mm-hmm,
to,
mm-hmm,
to explore these issues and give a contribution.
So what is your next project? What are you excited about working on moving,
yeah,
forward?
Yeah, so, you know, I've been studying basically perpetrators in the past 10 years. And that's also what got me involved in facilitating negotiations for a ceasefire in Colombia for a few years, and still close now to what is happening. But by doing this, I really got interest in this kind of young people that I was mentioning to you before, like this urban artists that have a sort of an anarchic quality, basically, because we are trapped between violent forces of organized crime and gangs or guerrilla and paramilitary and so on. But on the other hand, also by the state, because
mm-hmm,
you cannot paint with graffiti a wall, and so even the state is not really offering you a lot. But still, they are trying to create this alternative world with other values, a different narrative,
sure,
different spaces. And I've been intrigued by the creativity and by the strength of the proposal. So I think I want to understand what is happening in terms of space,
mm-hmm,
in these neighborhoods that are characterized by violence. But then you have these young people, many of whom might come from a history of violence, either as victimizer or as victims,
mm-hmm,
and they try to create a completely different paradigm. It's,
sure,
not even a resistance. It's,
sure,
really a transformation. It's really wanted to imagine a completely different world and actually give life to it. So
yeah.
I think my next fieldwork, my next research, also as a way to understand the possibility for peace in the midst of conflict,
mm-hmm,
will to hang out and to study
these pockets.
These pockets. These spaces.
Do you feel optimistic about the future ceasefire of the ceasefire in?
I actually think we are in a good moment,
mm-hmm,
in Colombia.
Mm-hmm.
I think on one hand, the guerrilla arrived at a point where the leadership understands that we are not gonna overthrow power through force. Mm-hmm. And once an insurgency realizes that, there is a huge consequence. Yep. in terms of why you are fighting and why you are using violence. Mm-hmm. And I think that somehow, even though explicitly, but because of the changes in leadership, the FARC guerrilla and also the ELN got to this point. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, I think there is, on behalf of the present government of Colombia, much seriousness in how you design a peace process. Mm-hmm. They are working in team, for example. There has been a long effort of consensus building, starting with the military. This is actually what is interesting. I think it's probably a trend today, but it's a peace process that was designed, started being designed and imagined within the Ministry of Defense with the collaboration of the military intelligence. Mm-hmm. So it has been quite comprehensive and inclusive from the state point of view. Mm-hmm. And so there is enough consensus compared to other efforts before in Colombia to have a confidence that the government is able actually to follow through the peace process. The team is very good, very experienced people. Yeah. There is a former student of mine on the team at Columbia University, very young fellow, very dedicated to his country. I think the circumstances promise. Then we know when a peace process starts, we never know when and how it ends.
Sure.
So we hope that it will end well and in a reasonable short time.
I think it's interesting that the process started or originated within the military. I think that there seems to be more and more. There's a film out called The Gatekeepers, which is a documentary film about former leaders of Shin Bet, basically terrorism squad of the Secret Service of Israel. And to a person, they advocate what they realize is that they're very, very good at winning battles and losing the war, and that the more and more efficient they get, the more ineffective they are ultimately at really building any peace. And it's an extraordinary thing that those directly involved strategically in the violence come to realize that it has no long-term gain.
Yeah, and actually, you know, it's you always have the most radical people in the military, like you have an insurgency, who absolutely, you know, try actually to be saboteurs of the efforts. But if you, in the great majority, those are the people who actually lose their lives, right, in the field. And in Colombia, they have been now fighting intensively for the past 10 years. And if for men and women who are in the field as soldiers, actually a very long time.
Sure.
And the same is true for the insurgency. Yeah. And I think there is an empathy between combatants and a sense of identification that is actually can be conducive to. Yeah. It's something that in the field of maybe of the conflict resolution, we should learn to appreciate more.
Absolutely.
Like the anthropologist should do more work with perpetrators. Mm-hmm. Maybe we should also, as peace builder, not be too afraid of getting tainted. Not by collaborating with the military, I don't think we have to do that, but listening to their stories, to their point of view, and taking into account. I think it's very important. I found it fascinating that in Colombia, a former retired general, one of the most tough ones, mm-hmm. was included in the peace talks. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was a smart move on behalf of the president, considering the history of Colombia. And the stories that we are hearing is that actually between the leader, the peace, the chief negotiator of the FARC, and these former generals, there's the greatest empathy. Mm-hmm. They're trading stories about if they were in the same fight, in the same battles, and it created empathy and confidence around the table. So, I think sometimes we ourselves need to be a little more open and recognizing that. Also, among the militaries, this might be the interest of.
No, I think that's a hopeful parallel. So thank you for your time. Our time is up, but thank you so much. I think your work is extraordinary. It is rich. It is grounded. But I look forward to reading the research as well and to generalizing, hopefully, from your...
Well, you have been always an inspiration, so I'm always happy to talk to you and learn from you as
Great. Well, thank you so much.
Bye.